Amberly Lago's survival story is nothing short of amazing. She had it all. She was living the California dream with her husband, her two kids, and then a random accident changed the course of her life forever. She's now detailed her journey in her new book, True Grit and Grace, Turning Tragedy into Triumph. And boy, is that true in her case. Here is Amberly Lago's story. Watch.
You know, finally, I had the man of my dreams. We had a baby. My oldest daughter was 13. And just life was good.
A wife, mother, fitness model, and personal trainer, Amberly Lago was living the California dream.
And I felt like the rug was pulled out from underneath me. Just in an instant, everything was changed.
911.
Hi, there's an accident on Ventura Boulevard. This girl came on her motorcycle, just totally got smashed.
Does she need paramedics?
She needs paramedics. The leg is twisted up and there's like
a truck hit the motorcycle Amberly was riding.
I immediately had pain. And I looked down at my leg and just held onto my leg, and it was just crumbled into pieces. It was like one of those scary movies where you see every, like, beat of your heart, the pulsing, the blood was coming out every beat. And I thought, oh, when people started approaching me, that's when I started to realize something, this might be more serious than I think, because they didn't run to me, they kind of walked and stopped and stood in place, and one lady fainted.
Amberly's husband, John, a retired police lieutenant, arrived quickly.
And I heard this just like wailing, and I was like, what is that? And it was my husband. And I said, Johnny, I need you to get over here and be strong for me. And the last thing I remember before they put me in induced coma was he held my hand, and the nurse said, we're going to give you something to make you feel all better now.
While Amberly was in a coma, doctors asked John if they could amputate her leg. He refused.
He said, when she wakes up out of a coma, I want her to be the one to make the decision on whether or not her leg is going to be amputated. I want her to have two legs when she wakes up.
Amberly's femoral artery was severed and her leg shattered. And the chance of saving it, just 1%.
Amberly would spend 3 months in the hospital and she underwent 34 surgeries. But nothing could keep her down. Amberly Lago, come on out. Thank you for coming. All right, so I know you want to hear about Amberly, and so do I, because the real story is not actually the accident. It is what happened on the road to recovery that is amazing. That's next. We're here now with Amberly Lago, whose life was forever changed when her motorcycle collided with an SUV. Against medical advice, she refused to allow doctors to amputate her heavily damaged leg, fought through countless surgeries and physical therapy. And she writes about all of this and overcoming that adversity in her book, True Grit and Grace, Turning Tragedy into Triumph. She knows of what she writes. Amberly, 34 surgeries. The pain on a scale of 1 to 10 that you went through in the recovery was what?
I would say about a 12.
So it was off. It was off the charts.
It was awful. Yeah, it was awful. And I thought the pain, you know, I thought, well, it's going to get better. And, you know, growing up, I was taught to push through the pain and suck it up and cowgirl up. And so I just thought this is part of it. You know, I think being an athlete and a dancer my whole life kind of helped me to keep sucking it up and move forward. But the pain was just horrible every day.
I know the doctor said, like, he showed you a saltine cracker. Is that what he said? There was,
yes,
basically to try to explain what had happened to your leg. Can you explain that?
He was in the cafeteria, my husband, and he ran into my doctor who saved my leg. And he was eating a bowl of soup, and he grabbed a saltine cracker, and he broke it. And he said, John, this is what a break is. And he crumbled the cracker, and it fell, and he said, this is what your wife has. So basically, it was just, it was crushed. It was completely shattered.
Which is why they really thought that you should amputate it. Mm-hmm. Why didn't you choose that? You know, a lot of people live with a prosthetic, and they do just fine.
you know, it was just never a choice in my mind, I think, because I was a dancer my whole life and then a fitness trainer in the fitness industry and a big runner, and I ran every day, and running was my, that was my go-to. That was my therapy. That was my drug of choice. That's what I always turned to. And I thought, how would I do that? You know, I know there are plenty of people out there that do run. There are Olympians, but for me, I just wanted to keep my leg. I just wanted to.
So all these surgeries later, 34 surgeries, tons of pain throughout the process. Mm-hmm. You grit it out. Then you find out you have something called complex regional pain syndrome, which they call suicide disease. Mm-hmm. Because?
There's no known cure. It leaves you in constant chronic pain, and the pain is ranked higher on the pain scale than anything, than, you know, passing a kidney stone, than childbirth. It's ranked higher, and there's no known cure. So you're left every day, if you're in a flare-up, especially, in constant chronic pain. And so people, once they find out, you know, that they're going to live the rest of their lives that way, a lot of times people slowly kill themselves with, you know, drugs or alcohol, or they take their lives right then and there.
This chronic pain is not only incredibly painful, obviously, to deal with, but it can cause great depression. Mm-hmm. It can just cause depression, and I know you suffered that as well. Mm-hmm. So how, you know, turning tragedy into triumph, how do you get past that? Because I think a lot of us would not be able to.
Yeah, you know, I was in a really dark place, and I think we all have that light inside of us. And for me, mine was getting really dim, and I think it was God's grace that got me through. I got on my knees and I prayed. I needed help. And I reached out to people for support. But I thought, you know, I have a choice here. I can either go down that road of despair and self-pity and depression, or I can make this better, make a life for myself. And so I got a notepad that I had, and I just started writing everything I was grateful for. And whether that be that it was, you know, in the hospital, that I had a view from the hospital room, but I wrote everything I was grateful for. I wrote down the nurses' names that came in to check on me, my husband, my family, my clients.
Everyone says that gratitude journal really works. Everybody says that works.
It works.
Can I ask you, because I know at some point you thought, did I make the right choice? Maybe I could just, you know, I'm in so much pain, just take it now. Now I will go for the prosthetic. And they said no, that you would still have this disease. You would still have complex regional pain syndrome, even if they took the leg now. Why? How can that be?
Well, I got to the point where I thought, I'm in so much pain. You know what? I made it through all these surgeries only to just be in constant pain. You know, I was so proud to be upright and walking, and I thought, when I learned that it's not going to get better, I said, just take it. Just amputate it. And they said, we can't do that. It's in your sympathetic nervous system. So for lack of a better term, it's like a computer that needs to be rebooted. So I've had every kind of treatment, from a spinal cord stimulator where they put metal leads in your spine, which didn't work for me. I had...
They've tried to manage it, but it's not... I mean, really, at this point for you, it's mind over matter.
It's a lot of mind over matter. It's a mindfulness, for sure, practicing mindfulness.
And listen, so it's like a lot of our viewers are going to be patients who are chronic pain patients. Mm-hmm. And read this book, because there's no way she doesn't get what you're going through with the 34 surgeries and the ongoing, you know, the suicide disease. It's a terrible term. And maybe there's hope. You know, if you can get through what you describe as like fire ants all over your leg, mm-hmm, on a daily basis, what else could you handle? What can the human spirit take and still be beautiful in every sense of the word? Amberly, thank you for sharing your story.
Oh, thank you.
Good luck to you. Good luck with the book as well.
Like most people, we kind of thought we had an idea of what healing looked like. But with CRPS, it looks more like this. And don't tell my mama about that cuss word in there. But, you know, my pain just wasn't getting any better. You know, the doctor said that it would take a long time to walk again, and I was in a hospital bed for a long time, and then a wheelchair, and I tried so hard to get up and stand up, and every time I would stand up, I would just have such pain that I would get back in the bed and I would stand up again and I would count for like 10 seconds. And then I'd have to lay back down and I'd do it again and again. And so I was finally up on crutches and I was feeling so proud of myself to be upright. And I had a doctor's appointment and I went in to see him and I thought he's gonna be so proud of me because I am upright on crutches. And they said it'd take like 2 years for me to be that way. And I sit down, the doctor comes in and he looks at me and he went out of the room. And I told my husband, I said, well, that wasn't the reaction I was going for. And he comes back in and he says, are you the kind of person that likes to push through pain? And I was like, yes, sir, I am the kind of person. I just push through with some Texas grit. He said, well, you need to stop. You need to get back in your wheelchair. Your life will never be the same. You'll be permanently disabled and you'll probably have to wear orthopedic shoes. And I was like, okay, I stopped listening after the word never, but when he said orthopedic shoes, I was like, oh, forget it. See, I wanted to look like this, but I look like this. And no wonder he ran out of the room. Who wouldn't? But, you know, I was determined to get better. And so I went to another doctor, but I really went to another doctor because I wanted him to say that I didn't have CRPS. And he didn't. He said, you've got CRPS. So then I said, well, I'm going to go to one of the top doctors in the world, and he's going to tell me that I don't have it. So I go in his office, and I was pretty, you know, feeling pretty proud because I was walking. I didn't have a cane or crutches or anything, so I thought he's going to tell me I don't have it. And I walked in, and he said, I don't think you have it. And I looked at my husband. I was like, see, I don't have it. He goes, well, let's examine you anyway. And he goes, you have it. And I was crushed. I thought, well, what do we do? So I started trying everything. I started trying. This is a good clicker. Let me see. I don't know how many times this clicks. Okay, let me go back. I tried ketamine infusion, spinal blocks, spinal radio frequency, Eastern, Western medicine, homeopathic. At one point, I was taking 73 pills a day because I had a homeopathic doctor that said he could cure me. I was doing acupuncture, acupressure. Basically, if you told me you had some snake spit that was going to cure me, I would buy it, and I didn't care how much it cost. We had a lien on our house. We borrowed money from friends. I was somebody who had never done a drug in my life, and now I was getting infused with ketamine. So I was still in pain, like nothing was working, and so I hit rock bottom. I was in a place where, I'm getting used to this whole slide thing. I hit rock bottom, and really what that means is I was broken mentally, spiritually, physically. I was in a dark place. I went from being, you know, an athlete, a successful personal trainer, to now all of a sudden I'm in a dark room by myself. I don't want to talk to anybody. My world got smaller and smaller. I shut everybody out. And, you know, almost dying is about as rock bottom as you can get because, you see, I was in denial about my diagnosis, and I tried to ignore it. And so there was such a cutoff between my body and my mind that I was trying to ignore the pain that I actually passed a kidney stone, which got infected, and I only was rushed to the hospital because I was like shaking in convulsions. And the doctor looked at me and he said, what are you, and when my husband took me, he kind of barely slowed down at the hospital and just kicked me out the door. After 34 surgeries, you're just like, oh, another time. So he left me there, and I had to call him, and I had to say, you know what, honey, they're admitting me. And he goes, what? Not again. And so he said, you're septic. He said, you don't look like you should be sick. You look pretty healthy. You don't look sick. And so that was the first time it really scared me. Like I thought, if I'm not listening to my body, I had a doctor say, you almost died. And so
I think the one thing that I found that really helped me get through that was resilience. By the grace of God, I had a little light left in me, and it helped me pull out of that dark space. And I started reaching out, and I want to share with you today kind of what I have done to build my resilience, because we all have it inside of us. You know, when I looked up at the dictionary what resilience meant, it didn't seem like me, because it says in the dictionary, able to bounce back to its original form or shape. And that's definitely not me, but I think for CRPS warriors, in fact, how many of you in here have been diagnosed with CRPS? Wow, oh my gosh. This is the first time I've been around so many warriors. Okay, gonna get it together. It's just when you are around so many people that get it. How many of you are here because you have a loved one that's been diagnosed with CRPS? Wow. Well, my hat's off to you, because I know, like, you know, that the only thing worse than, I think, my pain is knowing that my pain is causing someone else pain. But for us, I wanted to do more than just survive. I wanted to live a life, a full life. I wanted my life back, but even better. And so I think resilience, can y'all see, is the ability to adapt and overcome obstacles and roadblocks and thrive in the challenge. So we've got a lot of challenges, but we can still thrive. So my life turned into this. I had a doctor when I was being released from the hospital, and I said, I can't wait to get home. I can't wait to train my clients again. He said, well, I don't think you'll train clients again. I don't think you'll ever run again, and you'll never wear shorts again. Now I'm putting it on a screen. I'm in a bikini running with my daughter. That was my daughter, Ruby. She was two, and that was the first day that I ever ran again, and it was such an emotional day. Now, being resilient doesn't mean that I can't run every day. I can't run like I used to. But what I can do is focus on the things that I can do instead to make me feel better. The first thing that I had to do was I had to really accept my life with CRPS. Because when I was in denial, it wasn't working for me. It's real hard. Now, I don't go around complaining all the time, but I do say, it's hard wearing a smile on your face when you're hurting all the time. But I try to focus on what's good. I start, you know, every day I have a ritual that I go through to put myself in the right mindset. But the first thing I do is I had to really accept it. And I can't say that I did that on my own. I had people that helped me with that. This actually is the hardware. This wind chime right here is the most expensive wind chime you'll ever see. This is $52,000 worth of wind chime right there. That was the hardware that was in my leg. That's a whole other story. But my doctor who saved my leg, he said, why don't you make a wind chime? So I made a wind chime that hangs outside. But he is the one who really helped me with self-love, because I hated my leg. I hated it, and hate's a four-letter word in our house. And I hated it because it didn't work right. I hated it because it gave me so much pain. I hated the scars. I didn't want to accept them. And it wasn't until I went to see Dr. Wiss, and I went and I sat down in front of him, and he put my leg in his lap, and he just touched my leg like it was a work of art. He looked at it like it was his masterpiece. And I thought, wow, if he can look at it like that, then I can learn to love it again. And so I slowly started to love my leg a little bit. So when it gave me pain, instead of hating it, instead of being resentful about it, I turned it to love. And okay, let me acknowledge it and accept it, and what can I do to make this better? And now I'm going to admit something too. You know, I didn't like that I was stuck in my wheelchair. I didn't like that I was stuck in a scooter. And not because I don't have something against people in wheelchairs. I grew up, my little brother has been in a wheelchair his whole life. It's just that's not what I wanted. And so I was embarrassed until this happened. I went to Universal and I got out of my scooter and SpongeBob sat in my scooter and he wouldn't get out and he made it fun. And it changed my whole perspective. And then I had to go on a field trip with my daughter, and I knew I couldn't get around the zoo just walking, so I had a motorized scooter. And I thought, I'm just going to make this the coolest thing ever for kids to go on a ride with me. And so I let kids, they took turns riding, and I was like the coolest mom there because I was on the scooter and they could ride with me. So, you know, you have to like compromise and figure things out. And I was at my daughter's school one day and I'm like, it's pouring rain. What am I going to do? How am I going to walk on my crutches with an umbrella? And you know what? You figure it out. So I used my neck. And we would all, if we just did the things we were capable of doing, we would astound ourselves. So I gave you a card. Does everybody have one of these cards? If you don't, Jesse can give one to you if you don't have a card. You know, talking about resilience and when I really thought about what it was that builds my resilience every day, I didn't really have a toolkit. The toolkit that I had didn't work for me anymore. What I used to do for anything, whether it was, nervousness, sadness, depression, excitement, anything, I would run. That was my go-to. And now I couldn't run the way I used to. So I had to come up with a new set of tools. So today, if there's one thing in your life, whatever that may be, whether it's your situation at work, whether that's a relationship with a friend, whether that's your situation that you're in right now, write down one thing that you can do today that you can learn to accept. Because once we are in acceptance and we can fully embrace where we are, that's when we can find solutions to make us better every day. So think about that for a little bit. Anything that there's something you might want to write down that you could start accepting a little bit more. The next thing I want to talk about is gratitude. For me, gratitude is alchemy. It saved me. It turned depression, anger, fear, resentment, hopelessness, it turned that into being hopeful, determination, grace, and just plain badassery, really. When you're grateful, it changes, it shifts your life. When you can find one thing that you're grateful for, and people ask me all the time, they're like, well, how can you be grateful when you were stuck in a hospital bed? I was grateful for that I had a view. I was grateful that I had good doctors. I was grateful that I had people that came to see me. I was grateful for my family. We can always find something to be grateful for and switch that mindset. What I did, I actually took a picture. This is a picture of my journal. What was a big shift for me, this was in the hospital, and what I did every day is I journaled, and I think that was a way for me to, like, it was like a coping mechanism. I just had to get things out of my head and put it onto paper, and so that really helped me. And then every day, I would write down at the bottom, like, who came to see me, if they brought anything, and I think That was a way, maybe a little bit of my Southern roots. My mom was always like, don't forget to write a thank you note. Don't forget to write that thank you note. And so I was like, okay, let me write this thank you note. But what it did is it shifted my mindset. And when I was in the hospital, I remember there was one night watching TV, and the hospital, it's horrible at the hospital. It was just Law and Order. I got addicted to Law and Order. And then there was like other like infomercials. And so I was up in the middle of the night, and my pain was really bad, so I was trying to do anything to distract me from the pain. And I was watching some infomercial, and it was like how to get that Brazilian butt. And I was like, oh my God, I'm never going to have a Brazilian butt. And I was like, I just went into a pity party. I was like, I went from, you know, being featured. Now, this is true. I went from being featured in Shape Magazine, Elle Magazine, Fit Pregnancy, to Disability Magazine and AARP. No joke. That's acceptance right there. I'm in a different class now. And, you know, I just thought, I've got to do something about this. And so I thought, I better get grateful. And so that journal became my gratitude list. And every day when I had a thought of self-pity, I would turn that into something to be grateful for. Now, I still use that tool. I have to use that tool because it's real easy to slip down that side of darkness, and I don't want to ever go there again. I was there, and I don't ever want to go there again. So if you can, think of just one thing that you're grateful for today. Like, I am so grateful to be in a room with so many warriors that it just makes me emotional. But think about one thing that you're grateful for and write that down, and see if you can start writing one thing a day. For me, at night, my daughter and I, we lie in bed, my 10-year-old, she's 10 now, and I say, let's think of one thing that you're grateful for today, and usually it's something really silly. The other day it was, she was grateful that I pulled the splinter out of her thumb. And just being like grateful for little things, it just shifts your mindset. But I try to start my day with that gratitude and end it with something that you're grateful for. The next thing that really helps to build and strengthen your resilience is support. Now, I was the type of person, was very independent. I did everything on my own. I didn't need anybody's help. I ran a business. I had three trainers that worked for me. And I was bound and determined I was going to get through this, and I didn't need help. Well, let me tell you, when you are laying in a hospital bed and you have to depend on your husband to carry your bedpan, it's a humbling experience. And he still to this day will say, you remember I carried your bedpan for you? And I'm like, I know. But I learned the value of support, because I really learned like when to ask for help and when to accept help. When I needed help, and I needed a lot of help. I still need a lot of help. And you know, it was so important. It was a huge lesson for me to learn. And at this time when I was in the hospital, I needed my clients now more than they needed me. I needed a purpose. I needed a purpose to fuel me to get me out of that bed. I needed a goal. I needed to have some passion underneath me to get me going. So one of the things I started doing in the hospital bed was the nurses would come in, and my room was like the party room. I had my own fridge. I had healthy food. And the nurses would come in and say, oh, well, what can I do for my legs? What can I do for my butt? They knew I was a trainer. I'm like, oh, you can just do this or that. And so I started feeling pretty good because I was giving them exercises. And it made me feel good that I was doing something for somebody, even though I was stuck in that bed. And then I started making calls to trainers to arrange for my clients to still keep training. Then I had one of the trainers from the gym bring me some dumbbells so I could work out my upper body. Then the doctor thought I was completely crazy because I said, can you install a pull-up bar in the hospital bed so I can do some pull-ups because I need to stay strong.
And they did it.
And being of service and having the support, I had to ask for that. I had to know when to ask for that. Really, really makes a difference. But once you're home, your friends have visited you. They're like, why aren't you getting over this? Like, how come you're not getting better? I still get it all the time. Oh, you're walking with a limp. I'm like, really? Or what's wrong? And I'm like, oh, and it's hard to explain CRPS. Like, people don't get it. I sometimes say it's like a computer that needs to be rebooted. It's a constant loop of not the P word, Bill. I'm not going to say that word. And I noticed I talk slow. I'm going to start talking slower just after hearing you speak. But what do you do, like, for support when people don't understand you? Like, they don't understand your pain. And I think that's why I was emotional when I came in here, because I know you guys get it. But I also found a group of friends, and we get in a teepee every once in a while. And when you find those people who celebrate you, your quirks, whatever, you for being you, celebrate them with glad cries of me too. Be sure to cherish them, because those weirdos are your tribe. So you CRPS warriors, you're my tribe. You're my tribe. Let me see if this works. Oh, I had a little spotlight, but it's not working. I was hoping it would. But that's me in the middle of the tribe, and that's actually a wizard too. I don't tell my husband that I go in a teepee with a wizard. He'd really think I lost my mind. Oh. So make the most of this. Thank you. Make the most of this experience. Your tribe's sitting around the table right now, and I hope you guys get to know each other. I want to get to know all of you, because it wasn't really until I reached out and actually started talking about CRPS on social media did I find other people that had been diagnosed with CRPS. And it's powerful when you find someone that gets you, that understands what you're going through. And I'm not saying understands like we sit and we have a pity party. That's not what it is at all. It's just you feel like there's a connection. And it's so important, and I'm so inspired to bring more awareness to RSD or CRPS, because I had a friend reach out to me. She lives in Arizona, and she reached out to me through Instagram, and she said, her name's Patty, and she said, Amberly, I'm scared. I just was diagnosed with CRPS. I don't know what to do. I'm a Pilates instructor, and I'm really scared. Can you call me? So I called her right away, and I said, you need to take radical action. I asked her, have you done nerve blocks? Have you tried anything? She goes, no. And I said, go to your pain doctor right away. She's in remission. She had blocks, and they worked for her, and she's in remission. And so just the power of us sharing our story and connecting with other people, man, we can change somebody's life just by sharing our story. So I also want you to think about in your life, like, I know for me, I had to really kind of get rid of those doggy downers. I just want puppy uppers in my life. And so I want you to think about, you know, I mean, like, for instance, I had someone that would just come in and they felt miserable. They were so low energy, and they'd come to me to train on me and be like, oh, life is awful. It's just terrible. I hate it. I hurt everywhere. And I'd train them, and we'd talk positive talk, and they'd leave, and they'd be like, I feel great, you know, and then I would be like, oh, I'm so tired. And so it's so important to hang around people who empower you and people who make you feel good. My friend Kevin over there, we met through social media. I love him. He has been so supportive. Those kind of people, Jesse, like people that I've met, Heather, I just met. Well, we've emailed, and I got to meet her last night. And just to be able to connect and talk is powerful. And so I want you to think about somebody that you really, that supports you. Like your husband, we were talking, and your husband, like my hat's off to all the husbands that deal, or the wives that deal with their partner, and they want the woman they married or the man they married, they want them back. That's huge. So if you write down on your card, like, who do you want to spend more time with? Like, make that a priority. And who do you really need to spend some less time with? Like, who's bringing you down? You know, it's time to let go of the doggy downers, because we're healing. And we can't afford to have that negative pull on us. So anybody, can you guess what the number one question I get? Anybody? This microphone sliding down my behind. Oh.
How do you feel?
Okay, no.
How do you stay inside zero?
How do you manage your pain? Well, besides, where are you from? They say that they ask that too. But how do you manage your pain? So really, just a few nights ago, my husband and I were sitting at dinner, and I sat down, and I was just exhausted. I mean, I was so tired. I could barely pick up my fork. And he's like, why are you so tired? I'm like, dude, you try living with CRPS and being a mom and working, and it's a lot. And so I said, you know what? I'm going to really think about what it is. What do I do for my pain? And I wish that it was something that I could say, I do this, I take this, or, but it's not. It is a lot of things. It's a complete body, mind, spirit act. You have to wake up every single day and decide that you want to strengthen your resilience. So I was having dinner, and my husband is like, you need to pace yourself. You need to pace yourself. He kept saying, you need to pace yourself. And I was like, I do pace myself. He goes, no, you don't. And I wrote the word pacer. I'm like, I'm a pacer. And P is what I do. Like, I prepare for the pain. Like, I don't know about you, but, like, just to get ready, I have to make sure that I have pants that aren't too tight. Sometimes if I have anything too tight, like I have some really cute skinny jeans that I just can't wear, and I'm not letting them go yet. I just still have hope that they're going to work. I have to prepare, like, what shoes I'm going to wear. I swear it took me 8 years to find these shoes. 8 years. Because they're the same height as my boots, so I almost feel like they're a high heel. And that's a big deal to me. I love my shoes. And so they're not orthopedic. But I will switch into my orthopedics after this. But really, it's a lot of preparation, not just about what you wear, but what you do mentally for your pain. Do you wake up? What do you do when you wake up? When I wake up, before my feet hit the floor, I say a prayer. I say something I'm grateful for. I get up, and I get up an hour before anybody else so I can have this time in the morning. Plus, it takes a little while to get going, longer for me now than it does before. So I meditate, and I have an app if anybody's interested. I just downloaded it. It costs money, but I really like it. It's called Calm. And then I journal. And then I make sure I eat all the right things, and I'm really interested to hear Corey, who's going to be speaking later about the anti-inflammatory diet, because when I changed my food, it changed my life. My ankle was about five times the size it is now. And my doctor said, keep it up, because you need to keep your, you know, you need to stay healthy. You need to eat anti-inflammatory. You need to, because of the inflammation, the more inflamed I am, the more pain I have. So it's a lot of prep. It's a lot of work. Thinking about, you know, sometimes my husband carries my purse for me. That's the difference. Sometimes, you know, I don't carry my dog. I have someone carry my dog. So that first letter is for prepare. The second word is acknowledge. And that's such a big deal because before I just didn't want to accept the fact that I had CRPS and I didn't want to hear the pain and I would try to ignore it. I mean, you know, in Texas, we had those sayings like suck it up, get her done, hide your crazy, be a lady. And I didn't want to accept my pain, but pain demands to be heard. And it will, if you don't listen to it, it will start to take you down. So you have to acknowledge it. So the other day, I was at an event and I was on my feet and I could feel the pain coming up and I could feel it and it was getting more and I was like, okay, I have to acknowledge it. It's there. Okay, it's there. Then what am I going to do next? I did say cowgirl up, but my husband said I had to add a boy in there too. So cowgirl or cowboy up. And so what that is it's a fine line between what do you do? How hard do you push? Because I still want to do 10 times as much as I do now, but it's a fine line. It's a fine dance between are you going to do too much or are you not going to do enough? Because if I don't do enough and I don't exercise, guess what? I get depressed. I get in my head. I don't have those endorphins going. If I, you know, I want to enjoy myself, but if I do too much and I don't acknowledge and I push too hard on that pain, then I'm going to end up in a flare-up and I'm going to be on the couch for 2 weeks or more. So that one is hard. The next one is embrace. And for me, that took a long time to embrace the CRPS, to embrace the pain. And I think for me, pain has been one of my biggest teachers. It's taught me how to truly love myself because I had to learn to love all the scars and the leg that didn't work properly and love myself and think that, okay, if I can love myself, maybe my husband is still going to love me too. And then finally, R is for rest. Now, I used to think with my mentality as an athlete, I thought rest means quit. So it was a negative. It was negative to me. But rest means recovering. And that's what we're supposed to do. We're supposed to recover. Now, if any one of these is not working or you're not acknowledging it, if any one of them is off, you're not going to feel as well. You're not going to. And I mean, look, I'm no expert on this. I just thought I wanted to share with you my notes that I wrote on the dinner table because I feel like if we all share what helps, what works, like, you know, I know Heather's spinal stimulator worked for her for a while anyway. It's working. Didn't work for me, but, you know, maybe ketamine might work for you. Maybe Lyrica may work for you. Maybe Neurontin might work for you. But if we share what we're doing and we build our community, we get stronger, we get more informed, and we create awareness and a voice, and people are going to know about it. And this is like my favorite quote. I think that Julie Graham must have obviously read True Grit and Grace because it says, I don't know exactly what's next, but I'm stepping forward with grit anchored in grace. And you know, I don't know what's next. I don't know what's next. And I don't know if I'll feel like this for the rest of my life. I don't know if they'll find some way, some science that's going to fix it. But what I had to do, what we have to do, is figure out how can we live with the pain now and thrive, not just survive, but how can we do that? And I just want to know, want you to know that this was like a dream come true to get to come here and meet all of you and see all of you. And I my sincere wish is I hope that my story just inspires you a little bit and maybe shifts your perspective a little bit to just believe in yourself a little bit more. So thank you, and just really great to be here. Thank you.